You are listening to the American Urbex podcast. American Urbex advocates responsible urban exploration in the name of education, preservation, and adventure. You can find maps, detailed research, and photos from our explorations at americanurbex.com. You're listening to the American Urbex podcast. My name is Ken Fager, and I am sitting in the car getting ready to go home. I'm covered in sweat and dirt and all sorts of probably carcinogenic compounds, and I am in bad need of a shower. But I'm sitting just outside of Concord, North Carolina, by the Stonewall Jackson, Stonewall Jackson Manual Training and Industrial School. Had a great exploration today. I'm glad to say that I had some company on this exploration. Introduce yourself to us. What is your name, and where do you come from?
Hi, my name's Kyle Tretow. I'm originally from West Dallas, Wisconsin, right around Milwaukee area. I just moved down here a few weeks ago and got in touch with Ken, and here we are.
Now, I understand that you came down here to improve your lot in life. What are your plans to be in? What are you planning on doing here in North Carolina?
I intend on studying at the University of North Carolina at Charlotte. I plan on studying mechanical engineering. I have three more years left for transferring from University of Wisconsin at Madison. So.
Excellent. I've got the in there at UNCC Charlotte, or UNC Charlotte. I really like that place. I actually know your family. Your family kind of has a little bit of a history with this podcast. How so?
Yeah, my cousin Ryan Tretow was on here a few months ago, probably for his photography exposition in Milwaukee of the urban exploration that he's done. So,
Do you know any? Is he doing all right with himself now that he's graduated?
I assume so. If I remember correctly, he's moving out to Seattle within the next couple weeks.
Well, Ryan, if you're listening to this, best of luck to you wherever your life may take you, and I look forward to seeing some of your photos and Kyle's too. I understand that you're relatively new to Urbex. What have you done so far?
I am new. All that I've really done is I went through northern Michigan and looked at a lot of old mining towns, did a bit of photography work up there, and had a few disappointments along the line of places in Wisconsin that I'd looked at and found that they were currently in use by the public. So I've really only done one true exploration.
And I've you were telling me earlier that that one exploration was pretty harrowing. Tell me what place that was and what exactly happened to you, if you don't mind sharing.
No, not at all. I was going through an old mill, and there's a tunnel which goes below the road, and the mill is on one side, there's a smokestack on the other, and there is some type of old coal chute near this smokestack. And I was with a friend, luckily, as the ground beneath my feet gave out as we were going through underneath the smokestack, and I almost fell into what I assume used to be a coal pit that leads into the tunnel, which would have buried me alive. And luckily I caught myself and had a friend to help save me. So
it's very important when you're exploring these sorts of things that you have people with you, right? You definitely.
Yes, absolutely. That's a major plus.
Well, that's why I'm glad you decided to join me today and actually reached out. Since moving here to North Carolina, I've been trying to touch base with new explorers, and it's just strange that I would move 1,000 miles away from my last place and run into somebody from Wisconsin. So, and someone I am familiar with their family with. So let's talk about some of what you saw today at the Stonewall Jackson School. If you haven't read the American Urbex article already, which I just recently put out there, the Stonewall Jackson School for Manual Training and the Stonewall Jackson Manual Training and Industrial School. It had so many names. Whatever, it's Stonewall Jackson from this point on in the podcast for all intents and purposes. It was a reformatory that was built in started building in 1907, expanded rapidly, and it was an alternative for juveniles rather than being put in the judicial system that they would come to this school. and learn a trade. And the school is still standing. Part of the property, it's about 300 acres. Part of the property is still in use. And what else can I say about it? There are cottages all over the campus. About 30 boys lived in each cottage. And they're still standing. And if you drive by them, well, you know what, I'm going to quit rambling. Tell me some of your impressions about the school. What really impressed you about this location?
My impression was just the sheer size of it, and I was kind of amazed. I'd driven by it on the road a couple times and seen the archway over the road, which is the telltale sign that you're near the school, and I hadn't really put a whole lot of thought into, you know, how far back it goes as to what's still in use. I thought it was just a few buildings along the road, so looking at it today really kind of popped out that there's a lot of stuff here to look at. It's a lot of interesting things to look at. Just amazed by the old architecture. I'm a big fan of the old buildings and just the way things look when they've, you know, become a little run down. And I enjoyed looking at it. It was really interesting.
What was your favorite building? What was...
I'd have to say the main building. The name slips me right now.
I think it's Cannon Memorial Hall. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, that was the main one with the pianos in it. And there was also upstairs a really neat spot where there was, looked like a old foyer type thing, and had a glass door, and there was opening out to a balcony which would have overlooked the pillars at the front of the building. And I thought that was really unique. That struck me as pretty cool to see how that looked.
Now, you're just getting into this. What do you think was the best shot of the day for you? Try to describe to me the shot, your favorite shot of the day.
Let's see. There was a couple that I really liked. The one that I did like a lot was there was a weight bench in a corner next to a couple of windows, and the light was just coming in through the window so that it just put a little bit of shadow from the window frame, the slats in the window, put a little bit of shadow with the light just on the back of the bench. And the way the light kind of came in, it kind of put a yellowish tinge to it, probably from the dust in the air. And that was kind of a neat shot for me. It's just this desolate weight bench sitting there kind of in a light sunlight area.
What is it about this content, this subject matter that's so interesting for you? Why are you attracted to it?
I'm attracted just by, I love looking at how the shadows play and how the light reflects and reacts to things. And I like just a real sharp, clean shot where all you see is, here's your object and here's the shadow that the natural light will play off of it. That's what I really look for when I'm shooting buildings like this.
Was there any part that you found particularly difficult today about exploring?
Just my lack of knowledge as to how I know if I'm going to fall through a floor or not. I know I've been warned a little bit about falling through floors, and there was a couple times where I'd touch a spot and go, okay, maybe I shouldn't go here, it's a little precarious. So that probably, I kind of was a little apprehensive about getting into certain rooms here.
And I think that apprehension is appropriate. There were definitely some areas on this location that were clear that if we put any sort of weight on it, we definitely don't want to find out how deep the floor is underneath there. So I think your apprehension is absolutely appropriate for this. You have to take the highest precaution. I provided you with a mask, right? What did you think about? I'm very particular about, I use a certain brand of 3M mask. Did that work out well for you?
Oh, that was great. I could breathe clearly. It was nice.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of lead paint and asbestos in this place, so it's good to have that around your nose. You definitely don't want that piling up in your lungs. What do you think some of your family is going to say about some of this stuff? I mean, they're going to see the pictures eventually. We know Ryan's listening. You know, what would some of your other family members, whom I've had the pleasure of meeting in a Milwaukee bar once, what do you think they're going to have to say?
I don't know. I think they'll be interested, a little bit surprised, because I've never really, they know that I do photography, but I've always done sports and racing, and this is a complete opposite genre from that, where it's, you know, not something moving. It's something that's been still for the last 20, 30, 40 years of life, and I think they'll find it interesting and be a little bit surprised that I do this kind of work. So,
do you think they'll be pleasantly surprised?
I hope so.
I hope so too, but you are your own man, right?
Yes, I am. Yes.
Tell me about the challenges, because I've tried my hand at sports photography a couple of times, and it's a lot of motion, it's a lot of movement, it's a lot of split-second decisions. Tell me about some of that process and how it's different from Urbex photography when you're setting up shots.
Oh, it's two different worlds, because with sports, everything is shots that are taken at 1250, 2400, 2500, you know, they're high speed, a lot of lower aperture, so you get a blur in the background. With the racing stuff, those are hardest, I think, you know, because you have a car coming at you at about 140, 150 miles an hour, and you have to follow it to get the motion blur in the background. But those ones I do like to shoot down around 250, you know, 125 even, if I'm really pushing it, to get a real nice blur and really make it look like the cars.
Now, for the listeners who may not be aware, what do those numbers mean? The 250, 125, what is that?
That's just the amount out of a second that the shutter is closing. So yeah, it's different, because I'm going from a world where I can take five burst shots in a row of something that moves past me within 2 seconds or something like that, and, you know, get a nice blur in the background, to something where I have to sit still for, or put it on a tripod for 2 seconds to get a nice look with the shadow and the low amounts of light that come into these old buildings. So,
Kyle, where can we see these photos from today's adventure?
I'm on Flickr. You can just search my name, Kyle Tretow, search it under people. My page is on there. I have the pictures from the mines in Michigan are on there, as well as I think all my racing from the past year, and there's a couple other sports galleries on there too, if you're interested to go take a look at.
And I'll post those links too up on the podcast page when I on American Urbex when I post this. You know, what? Maybe I jumped the gun asking you where people can see your photos and everything, but I'm curious, you know, what's the next step for you? Is this Urbex something that you're going to explore some more? You definitely want to get your feet wet? I mean, what would you like to see now that you've had a taste?
Honestly, now that I've really seen what it really is and looked at it, I'd like to do a lot more. I know I've been kind of surfing the web just trying to find places around the area that are, you know, within a couple hours drive, nothing too far, that would be interesting to shoot at. And I also notice a lot of times when I'm driving around down here on the backcountry kind of roads of abandoned houses or gas stations or things that I keep a mental log of, and I know one day I'd like to go look at them if I get the time.
You know what? I think I might have to join you on that, because it's completely different from the Midwest down here. It's Midwest, you could just drive around and find a lot of stuff, being such a heavy industrial base for the United States. But here in the North Carolina, in the southern Appalachians, I hope I'm saying that right, they tend to save space. Things come down pretty quick. So we got our work cut out for us, don't we?
Yes, we do.
All right. This has been Kyle Tretow. I'm Ken Fager. You've been listening to the American Urbex podcast. Kyle, thanks for your time.
Thank you very much for having me.
All right. Let's go clean up. How about?
All right,
okay.
Good.
All right. Thank you for listening to the American Urbex podcast. Be sure to explore AmericanUrbex.com to keep tabs on our latest Urbex outings. Twitter users can get real-time updates by following at American Urbex. If you're a Facebook user, we've got you covered at facebook.com/AmericanUrbex. If you have a comment or question for American Urbex, please send them to AmericanUrbex@gmail.com.